and welcome back to Book Lust. I'm Nancy Pearl. My guest today at University Bookstore is author Guy Gavriel Kay. Guy, thank you for coming by.
Oh, Nancy, it's so nice to be back here.
This has been, I think, this is the fourth or fifth time that we've talked together, either on a stage or for the TV cameras.
You know what? I'm not tired. Are you tired?
No. I was very excited when your new book, Children of Earth and Sky, was announced, and I knew that I would get to see you in Seattle one way or another.
That's great.
So the new book is set in the same world that two of your earlier books take place in, Serantium. Mm-hmm. Is that how you pronounce
yep.
it?
Yep.
Because in my mind, as in your mind, I believe, equated to or related to Byzantium.
That's right.
So what made you want to, let me back up and say, I loved that the Serantium mosaic, which mm-hmm. is what the two books are called, Sailing to Serantium is the first one of my favorites of your books. What made you want to go back to that world?
Well, in a sense, it is and it isn't, because the new book is 900 years later. So it's
But who's counting?
Past a certain age, you don't worry about right. centuries.
Right.
But in another sense, that 900 years means that it can't possibly be a sequel. We're in a completely different
right.
culture and time frame. I went back because I had two things embedded that it seemed silly not to stay with. And one was the religions that were already established, the surrogate alternative religions in my near Europe mm-hmm. that I work with, that quarter turn to the fantastic I do.
Right.
And the other with the geography. I had both the essence of the religious conflict that I could work with, and I had the terrain, the space that I could work with. And it seemed silly not to stay with that, even though I wasn't doing a sequel. Once I started writing, I did what I've done in a couple of other books too, which is grace notes, small glancing allusions to earlier books.
Mm-hmm.
And the task there for me, the challenge, is that somebody who has never read a book of mine has to be able to enjoy every one of them as a one-off.
Right.
Without feeling they're missing the inside joke.
Right.
At the same time, those who have read the earlier books get what some readers were calling in the past the squee moment, when you recognize or catch a reference, a small reference. I don't want to do any kind of grand, unified field theory of the universe
right.
in my writing. I'm not putting together some universal, coherent set of worlds. I'm writing individual stories, and when it seems to be an advantage to make use of something that I've done before, I will.
Well, would you include then the Lions of Al-Rasan in that world
sure,
as well?
It is, and uh-huh. so is Last Light of the Sun.
Right.
Which is Lions, is Islamic Spain
right.
and the beginnings of the Christian reconquest in that quarter turn.
Mm-hmm.
And Last Light of the Sun is Vikings and Anglo-Saxons and Celts
right.
in the same general setting. I used two moons in all of those. From the very beginning, the two moons were kind of a quiet signal to the reader that we are not here.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
That wasn't meant, again, to be anything substantial. It was just that signal that we've shifted just a little bit
mm-hmm.
for a whole variety of reasons. I like to do that.
Or sort of saying to the reader, okay, pay attention now. This is not our world.
Yeah. But it's close.
Yes,
it's
very
close.
It's close
enough that people catch associations, and it's also gives me and the reader, because any advantage for the writer is an advantage for
mm-hmm.
the reader. It allows me to sharpen focus on themes and periods in history. In Lions of Al-Rasan, which you mentioned, I collapsed the reconquest of Spain, which took several hundred years.
Mm-hmm.
I can collapse that into a couple of generations to give the reader the emotional and ideally intellectual sense of what it might feel to see a culture die and another supersede it.
Mm-hmm.
You can collapse that when you work with that slight shift
right.
to the fantastic.
Right. So is that, in summary, why you became a novelist rather than a historian?
Oh, I think I became a novelist because I love telling stories. The storytelling impulse, I think we all do.
Yeah.
At a certain level, the storytelling impulse is, for me, one of the defining traits of Homo sapiens, if you will. We tell each other stories one way or another, and the novelistic impulse in me is to marry storytelling with character. I truly dislike what you hear so often, Nancy, about people seeing it as an either-or thing. This writer tells a great story, but she can't develop character, or this one is so wonderfully observant about her character,
right.
but it's navel-gazing and lagging in narrative verb.
Right.
And it's almost as if readers and writers are divided into those two solitudes. And I think it's our job as writers to try to deliver both.
When you departed Europe to move to China to write those two books that were set in China, what was the impulse behind that move?
I fell in love with the Tang Dynasty poets. I'd actually been reading them many years before, and I can't even remember why I got back to them, but I started reading about the poetry, in the poetry, obviously in translation, of the great Tang Dynasty writers, and I became intoxicated by it. So whenever I finish a novel, I'm never sure what the next one will be. In fact, it's even worse than that. I have no idea what the next one will be. And reading in those poets gave me that bee in your bonnet moment to say, do a little research in that specific period of Chinese history, the 8th century, really. And Nancy, almost from the get-go, when I started reading in the great titanic rebellion that started the downfall of the most powerful dynasty China had ever known, I'm thinking, yes, there's space and room for me to do some of the things I like to do.
And so the first of the two China books is Under Heaven, which is yet another of my, it's embarrassing because I keep saying, oh, this is my favorite book, this is my favorite book. But Under Heaven is just absolutely wonderful, as I believe I said when it first came out to you. But when the opening chapter in Under Heaven, which is so remarkable, and I mean just so beautifully told, comes from one of those poets, right?
That's right.
Yeah.
That opening chapter is one of those cases where taking a chance as a writer ends up finding a reward, because I knew it was going to be exceptionally quiet. It is one man by himself by a definitively remote mountain lake, burying the dead
right.
of a war. And he's alone. There's no, in those opening scenes, there's no obvious conflict, tension, drama out of other characters
right.
doing things. It felt risky, but it also felt right. Because, as you say, the great, great Chinese poet, Du Fu is his name, probably the greatest of all of them, wrote a poem called The Ballad of the War Wagons that ends with a reference to the ghosts of dead soldiers by a remote mountain lake wailing in distress because they had not been buried. And that image, the poem is heartbreakingly wonderful. That image launched me into a set of images that I could use for the opening of the book.
And yet, one of the things that you do in that opening chapter is tie this kind of ghostly atmosphere where the young man's only companions are the dead. But you give it a very human, you add a human emotion because he's doing this for his father.
Yep. It's the mourning period.
Right.
He's doing an atypical manifestation of the requirement in Tang Dynasty China, which was to withdraw from society for 2 years when mm-hmm. a parent died. And normally you went home and you stayed away from the company of others for 2 years out of respect. He has obtained permission to go to that battlefield because his father had been a general at that battlefield. So his way of addressing his father's guilt and contrition over all the dead in those wars mm-hmm. is to try to make redress himself for those dead soldiers. One of the things that really interests me, Nancy, is the idea, when I write about history, of making the world of my characters be the way they believed it to be. Mm-hmm. So if at that time in Chinese history people believed that the unburied dead would be ghosts in distress and sorrow, I will make that real. Mm-hmm. And the reason for that is it takes away the smugness we sometimes feel, the sense of superiority that we know so much more than people in the past did. Can you believe the foolish things they believed?
Right.
If I make it real, if they believed that the dead needed to be buried in order not to be ghosts, I will make that an actual thing in the book, and it takes away that feeling the modern reader can have of how foolish they are, mm-hmm. because it's actually happening. Mm-hmm. And if I do it right, it shortens the space for the modern reader to my characters. They don't have that detached feeling of superiority.
Do you think a lot of readers feel that sense of superiority to?
I think we do. I think that at times we may feel we may be angry and frustrated with our society and our world mm-hmm. politically. We can be, as Americans, can be frustrated with our government. But the reality is that there's an embedded sense that we know more than people in the past did. Mm-hmm. There's a general science has mm-hmm. moved us forward.
Right.
The quaint beliefs, the word that often comes up when I see people writing about it, so quaint, or even it's so cute what they used to believe.
Right.
We mock it, you know. It's a witch if it floats, and it was an innocent woman if she drowned in the water.
Right.
You know, we make jokes about that.
Yeah.
But embedded in those jokes is a feeling that the beliefs of the past, the worldview of people in the past, was foolish. Mm-hmm. And I like to write about history in such a way as not to make the people of the past feel or seem foolish.
And you certainly succeed from my having read a lot of fantasy in my time perspective. There is a lot of fantasy out there. Seemingly every time I look at a publisher's list of what's coming out, there are fantasy novels, and this is for all ages, for adults on down to 8 and 9 year olds. What do you attribute? First of all, do you think there's more being written and published now than there ever has been?
I think that, remember that the book industry, like the film industry, is a copycat industry on the commercial side. And so whenever a particular strand of book or television or film becomes successful, you are going to see the copycatting, the cloning mm-hmm. taking place. So there have been some obvious, powerful examples from Lord of the Rings through Harry Potter through Game of Thrones and fantasy, through Marvel superhero movies. These have had extreme, if you will, penetration mm-hmm. into mainstream culture, not genre culture. Mm-hmm. So I think, yes, I think you're going to see more of that in the media and on the media. The interesting thing for me is, parallel to that, pop culture emergence, you're seeing a lot of serious writers making use of elements of the fantastic, because the stigma is gone. It's no longer the sort of thing you hide under your mattress.
Right.
B, because if they're younger, they grew up with this.
Uh-huh.
It's dead center in their cultural worldview that all of these works, a young writer who is 30-something now grew up with Harry Potter.
Right.
certainly the Lord of the Rings films. So there's no marginal aspect to it. So you'll see some very serious writers saying, this is available to me, in the way that in my generation, someone like I watched and read Gabriel Garcia Marquez, right. 100 Years of Solitude, using elements of the fantastic which were labeled magic realism. But I've always joked that magic realism is what critics want to call a fantasy when they like it.
Yeah, yes, right. And so you never see Garcia Marquez's books shelved with the fantasy.
No.
The fantasy. But it does seem, in a way that fantasy has overtaken in popularity science fiction.
I think that happened a long time ago because of Tolkien, and because science fiction is less amenable to being cloned.
Mm-hmm.
Fantasy has certain locked-in, traditional fantasy, certain
right.
locked-in templates,
right.
patterns, the traditional fantasy, the heroic quest,
right.
the goat herd who's actually the prince.
Right.
The missing sword, all of those things which can be used brilliantly, can also be used in a pedestrian way, but will still sell books
mm-hmm.
because people have an appetite for repeating it. The same way in the mystery or thriller field, you'll have a few people writing brilliant books
right.
and a lot of people writing copycat books.
Right.
Science fiction's harder
mm-hmm.
to do the copycat thing with because it doesn't have as many locked in, embedded templates
right.
in the field. It presents itself as a fiction of ideas.
Mm-hmm.
And the fiction of ideas doesn't really allow for cloning as much.
And
I mean, there's a bad pun in there because it could be about cloning.
Right, right. Is there, but does that say, does that answer a question that I've been wondering about, which is why science fiction is less, not only does it seem like there's less coming out and around, you know, sort of in the zeitgeist and on the bestseller list, but also when you talk to somebody now who reads fantasy and science fiction, as we group them together in libraries and bookstores, it's really fantasy that they're talking about. And do you think that's because, or why?
Well, I think we're dancing around the answer. I think fantasy is what took over pop culture.
Mm-hmm.
So that people got a taste for, an appetite for, from television and film. I think that's feeding back into the book
into
world.
Into the book
They're
world.
The ones that got into pop culture. Now, you could call me on that, because we can make the observation that Star Wars was locked into the pop culture, and there are a lot of Star Wars style
right.
cloning that went on. But I think it's still right now in our time, we're riding a wave of fantasy in the culture. And if you and I sit down in 5 or 8 years, we may have a conversation about a completely different wave playing out in the culture. That's how it works, I think, these ebbs and flows.
Well, I was talking to somebody at Apple the other week, and he said the reason he became an artificial intelligence researcher was reading Asimov. And I wonder what the effect on science and actually this notion of the fiction of ideas.
I think that's a really interesting observation. I mean, you're not going to sit down with someone who says, I decided to become a warlock because
right.
I read
right.
something about
right.
her.
Right, exactly.
Or if you do, don't tell
yeah,
me.
Yeah, right, right, right. I am really puzzled about the popularity of George R. R. Martin's books. Now, I have to say, I'm a fan mm-hmm. of his books, but I don't understand this headlong rush into, maybe it's not a rush anymore, but this adoration of the world that and the characters that he's created. I'm happy people are reading, and I'm happy people are reading those books, which I think are well worth reading. But why?
Don't you want to just go with the three-letter answer and say HBO?
I thought you were going to say the three-letter answer, S-E-X.
I think HBO did it. I think HBO did it. I think that the simple reality is that the show... Now, you might ask me, why did the show become so successful, which would be a different question.
Right.
But if you're talking about the books, George's sales took off when HBO's series took off.
Really? Because when I wrote Book Lust, I had not read any George R. R. Martin, so I didn't include it among my 1,000 well-loved books.
Is he still speaking to you?
You know, I've never met him. But then, and people wrote to me, I mean, furious, you know, mm-hmm. outraged, not furious, but outraged that I hadn't included that book, and I then went to try to read it. I couldn't get past 50 pages. It didn't speak to me. I tried it again 3 years later. It did not. I read the same 50 pages. It didn't speak to me. And then on my third try, for some reason, I got into that world. And I ended up reading all
Isn't
of them.
Isn't it interesting? I mean, what you're saying, and to take it a bit wider, that whole question of our being ready for or not ready for. We talked about this before.
Right.
There's a moment, and I always put it this way, that if I write a novel, if I put a book out there for you, it's not a monologue. It's not me doing a monologue. It's you and I, you as a reader, in a dialogue.
Right.
Or me with a wide range of readers in conversations, and the reader brings something very substantial to that equation.
Right.
It can be the wrong book for you, it could be the wrong time for that book for you.
You could be in the wrong mood.
And there is so much of the consumer of the art that matters in whether or not a book will work. How else can we have discussions about a book if you can say, I couldn't finish this and I said I devoured it overnight. We love these conversations.
Yeah. Right.
And
right.
the essence of it is that it's a conversation.
Well, I just was in a book discussion where we talked about Italo Calvino's If on a Winter's Night, A Traveler. And
that's a favorite book.
And then one of the points many people did not care for in the group, did not care for that book and felt that they were just so, that they wanted him to stay with one story and not go on. But my feeling was that it was such a good example of the way we as readers and as non-readers, as living our lives, move through narratives, move through other people's narratives, and not ever get to the end of, or very seldom, with very few people, get to the end of that particular story.
One of the things that book made me think about was how often we will say, I love this book, and then, and I'll do this to people because I'm a tough reader, I'll say, yes, but the ending didn't really work. And they'll say, you're right, it didn't really work, but I loved the first part so much that I forgave it.
Right.
And that book, which is a sequence of beginnings, different beginnings that have no ending, actually, for me, addressed that feeling we have, which is, if you hook me, if you draw me in, it may not matter for some readers how well you wrap it. Now, I'm contrarian there. I'm obsessive about my endings as a reader and as a writer.
Mm-hmm.
It really matters to me that a book wrap consistent with what I'll call the arc of the story. It's one of the reasons I don't write the 3, 5, 8 volume series, because I really do see a novel as something having that arc. And if you're stretching it out over many, many books, you're doing a different art form, actually.
Well, I had an interesting experience. I just was reading a thriller, and I normally, if I'm reading a thriller and it gets too intense and I just cannot stand not knowing what happens, I will...
Do you go to the back?
I do. I do. I go to the back, and I find out what happens, and then no matter what it is, I feel more comfortable, and then I'll go back and get to the end. But I was reading this on an e-reader, and an e-reader is just hard enough
that
to get to the
That's
end
very funny.
That I couldn't, I just, I had to, like, you
And
know.
How did you feel about that?
I was a little annoyed.
Because it forced you out of your preferred rhythm.
Right, right, yeah. Because I just wanted to do that.
So my older son and my mother-in-law both go to the back of a book.
Uh-huh. I would, somebody asked me, well, if you knew how your life was going to end, would you want to know that? And in some ways, yes, I think I would, because then I could prepare myself for that.
That's what's coming up with a lot of people doing DNA testing, mm-hmm. is that in theory, it's giving you knowledge
right.
that depending on your nature,
yes.
you want or you don't
right.
want. I will never jump to the end of a book. That my feeling is always the person who's writing the book gets the right to tell me what they want to tell me when they want
yeah,
to tell
no,
me.
No, I think I appreciate
but
that.
But a thriller can be different because then they're capturing something in your own anxieties.
Yes.
And they don't necessarily have the right to make you so anxious that you can't handle
right, that
it.
You that's can't a, stand
that's
it.
The dialogue.
Right.
It's your own anxiety. You've got a right to deal with that.
Well, who are you reading now?
Right now, don't laugh at me, but I'm traveling with my iPad, and I'm not even carrying my book on the road
uh-huh.
because I figured out that if I show up on tour, I've been doing 10 airplanes in 13 days. If I show up on tour at a reading and there are no copies of my book, it's totally messed up anyhow. So I'm not even carrying
right.
mine. I'm carrying the iPad, and I've been reading Edith Grossman's translation of Don Quixote again,
uh-huh.
and I'm having so much fun with the Don.
Uh-huh.
I bought in Victoria, I do The Busman's Holiday, I'm always in bookstores
right.
on tours, and I bought Ann Tyler's most recent book because
mm-hmm.
it just came out in paperback,
mm-hmm.
and I've enjoyed her forever.
Yes, yes.
Probably the book that I've been recommending most people in the last 12 months is Helen MacDonald's H's for Hawk,
mm-hmm.
which I thought was a brilliant piece of writing.
And was one of the things that you enjoyed about that book was kind of tying in the whole King Arthur, yeah, yeah.
The T.H. White, it's
right.
very much the fact that the book is about her grief and her isolation and the isolation of T.H. White, who wrote The Once a Future King, which
yes.
is another favorite book.
Right.
And the stitching of the two together over the fact that they both tried to train a goshawk.
Yeah, right. Yeah, and you know, her isolation and her grief in many ways mirrors Arthur's isolation
mm-hmm.
and his
and the withdrawal
missteps
from the world.
And
yeah.
the withdrawal from
yeah.
the world.
I thought it was a beautifully written book.
Yeah, and it was very nicely produced too. I mean, the paper was nice. The everything
Doesn't that
was
matter
nice.
Too?
Absolutely.
I mean, we must be book people because
yes,
we like
right.
that. I have one edition of one of my books. I'll send people out looking for it. The Canadian edition of Song for Avant. By complete accident, got printed on art book quality paper. If you hold
wow.
that hardcover next to any of my other hardcovers, it weighs significantly more
yeah.
because the printer had an extra amount of art book quality paper, and it's a favor to Viking Penguin.
Uh-huh.
They printed, I love that
yeah.
book. When I signed that book, I actually, people laughed at me, I heft the book. And I pointed out to readers, I called people up to the table
uh-huh.
to balance two books.
Wow.
But yes, these things matter.
Yeah. Guy, it's just been a delight, as always. Good luck with the book and the rest of your tour. And I look forward to seeing you when the next book comes out.
I'll look forward to it too, Nancy. Thank you.
You're welcome.